Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Like many of you, I grew up in the era of televised Christmas specials. It was during the 1960s that many of what are now Christmas classics were first aired. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, A Charlie Brown Christmas, The Nutcracker, How the Grinch Stole Christmas, Frosty the Snowman, and A Christmas Carol. I was introduced to this great story at the age of 5 when the animated version of it shown on TV, in that particular version, Mr. Scrooge was played by the nearsighted cartoon character Mr. Magoo. Does anyone here remember that version of A Christmas Carol? I know I'm dating myself. Since those days, countless Christmas stories have been written and have become part of our pop culture. Home Alone, The Polar Express, The Santa Claus, A Christmas Story, The Nightmare Before Christmas, and Elf, just to name a few. And then there are the real classics. It's a Wonderful Life, Miracle on 34th Street, White Christmas, and of course the beloved poem, 'Twas the Night Before Christmas. Christmas is story time, and these stories have sparked our imaginations and shaped our traditions and our practices during the holiday season. They have really impacted our culture this time of year. The Christmas story, the real Christmas story from Luke chapter 2, is easily lost among the images and plots of so many stories that, like the others, it is often relegated to the category of legend or fairy tale. But the story around which we gather this night is so much more than a holiday legend, a children's tale, or a bedtime story. It is even more than the reason for the season. It is the key event within a much larger and grander narrative, the overarching story of God's redemptive love for all of his creation. The letter to the Hebrews begins this way. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets, but in these last days, he has spoken to us by a Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the worlds. From the beginning, from the very beginning, God has spoken to us, communicating his love and revealing his plan to save and redeem all of creation. It was a plan for the fullness of time, to gather up all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. And when that fullness of time had come, God spoke. And this time his word became flesh. The nativity of our Lord is the point in time in which God's story intersected with our story in a way that it never had before. It's not that God was distant or detached from our world before this, by no means. From the beginning, God has been about his mission of caring for and redeeming this world. He saved Noah and his family. He chose and blessed Abraham and Sarah. He led Israel out of slavery. He provided the law. He spoke through the prophets. He promised a Messiah. And then, in God's perfect timing, he came. God sent the Messiah, his only begotten Son, to bring his kingdom near to us and to provide for our salvation. And so it came to pass that when Quirinius was governor of Syria and Israel was oppressed under Roman rule, and Emperor Augustus decreed that all the world should be numbered and accounted for, at that point in history, God came to us in the most unexpected and quiet way, as a newborn. And the story of God's love, the story of Christmas, draws us in and it stirs our hearts. We know about birth. We know the fear and the hope that it brings. We understand the vulnerability of a newborn, and we are moved to compassion for Mary and Joseph as they bundle their baby against the cold and harsh realities of this world. With the shepherds, we gaze in wonder at the baby in the manger. And as we take in the sight, the words of the angels ring in our ears. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. This is the story that takes our breath away. It fills us with awe and amazement that God would reveal himself to us in such a humble way. Yet, in all his frailty and helplessness, the baby born in Bethlehem was the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being. God's great story of salvation continues, of course. It continues after the manger. And soon enough, we'll be leaving Bethlehem for Egypt, and from there to Nazareth, to Galilee, and finally to Calvary, just outside Jerusalem, where Jesus is nailed to a cross. As the story plays out, it becomes clear that Jesus was born for a greater purpose than to be forever adored as a sweet baby boy. His mission was to redeem and save the world, and his work would not be finished until he took his last breath on the cross. This is the hard and the glorious truth of the Christmas story, that Jesus was born to die. And the haunting words of "What child is this?" remind us, "Nails' spear shall pierce him through. The cross be borne for me, for you. Hail, hail, the Word made flesh, the babe, the Son of Mary." Jesus was sent by God for this reason, to bear the sins of the world, to suffer and to die, and 3 days later be raised to life. The truth is, we really don't know the Christmas story unless we know the stories of Good Friday and Easter Sunday. So on this holy night, we share in Holy Communion, remembering the words of our Lord on the night he was betrayed. In the bread and in the wine, we receive forgiveness, life, and salvation, gifts of a gracious God who truly is with us and for us. God sent us more than a baby. He sent us a Savior. So as Christmas Day is fast approaching, know and believe that God's story has become your story. Listen. So listen again to the story. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, on this holy night, we thank you for the gift of your Son. The baby whose birth we celebrate is the hope of the world. Fill our hearts with the wonder of your love. By your grace, may we live in the new birth that is ours through Jesus, your Son. Amen.